Praise the Lord, church. We're so glad to have everyone here tonight. We welcome you, those that have come to spend an evening of worship at Christian Life Center. We welcome you and thank you for taking time, especially our guests, to come and be with us. It's so nice to see Brother Ben Nolan, good friend of our pastor, Pastor Ensey. We welcome him today. Can we give him a hand clap of welcome? What a great day it is to be a part of the good things that God is doing. And we're going to go to God in prayer. We're going to open this service with prayer. I'm sure that there are those that are here tonight have come with needs. And we want to remember Brother Eric Holyak. He's very sick tonight. And Brother John Persinger, he's got some back trouble. And I believe that we're serving a God that can do anything but fail. How many can say amen to that? And we want to worship the Lord. I'm just going to ask you to stand with us. We're going to pray and open this service up. Then our ushers are going to wait on us for our offering. But I want to build your faith for just a minute. This morning, Sister Dorothy Yoakum called, and they have had a miracle in their family. And I'm not going to go into details about it, but God is working miracles all around us. Sister Hawd, praise God. Give it up for God Almighty. Praise God. Sister Hawd called last night, and they've had a miracle in their family. And I'm telling you, there's miracles everywhere. Monday night, we had a powerful prayer meeting yesterday morning. The men gathered, and so there is no reason not to believe that God can do anything but fail. How many believes that? Will you pray with me as we open this service tonight, believing that God is going to touch hearts? If you've got a need, lift your hand. Let's believe God as we call names out and we call issues. Father, in Jesus' name, every hand that's been raised in this service tonight, every individual that feels their need, Lord, of your greatness, I come to you in the name of Jesus, believing that healing, deliverance, and graciousness is going to be poured out. I bind every sickness, every disease, and every affliction. We thank you, Lord, for what you're going to be doing. God, for Sister Garner, as she goes in for that procedure in the morning, cover her with the Holy Ghost. Meet her every need. Touch Brother Eric. Touch Brother John. We lift them up to you, believing that in the Holy Ghost, everything is going to be secured. Let the church say hallelujah. Hallelujah. One more time. Hallelujah. Praise God. Let's worship the Lord as our ushers. Ushers from the back to the front, to give our offering to the Lord on this Wednesday night. Will you do that in Jesus' name? Father, we love you. We thank you for this offering we're about to receive. We ask you to bless every gift and every giver. Help us, Lord, to build your kingdom on the in the front, Lord God, whether it requires finances. We ask you to bless what we're doing. We give you honor for it in Jesus' name. Amen. As our ushers come to your pew, just move forward and give unto the Lord.
Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus,
sing it again.
Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all.
From beginning to the end.
Beginning to the end. It will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, enough.
Be the center, it's all about you.
up. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, it's all about you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. And from my heart to the heavens, and Jesus be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you.
From my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center.
Magnify Jesus. Let's magnify him. He is our central focus. Everything that we do, everything that we are, it's because of Jesus. We magnify you, Lord. Hallelujah. We worship you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. You are worthy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. It's all about him. It's all for him. It's all because of him. I'm here tonight because of Jesus. He died for me. He saved me. He delivered me. He healed me. I'm thankful to know him tonight. I'm thankful that he's here in this place, and I'm thankful that you're here in our service tonight. It's good to be together. So good to be in his house. What a wonderful week we have had. Powerful service on Sunday. Incredible prayer meeting on Monday. God moved in such a wonderful, powerful way. Great prayer meeting yesterday morning with our men. It's been a good week around here. If you want to spend time with Jesus just about any day of the week, you can come to CLC and there's somebody here at some point spending time with him. He is our central focus. It's all about him. I preached a few weeks ago, our mission is Jesus. It's about getting to Jesus and getting other people to Jesus. Because if we can just get in his presence, we know everything's going to be all right. It's going to be okay no matter what we're facing, what we're dealing with. I'm thankful to know that we have access to him. In his presence, there is fullness of joy. I believe everything that we need, we find in Jesus. The songwriter said, it's all in him. It's all in him. Anybody know that tonight? It's all in Jesus. Everything we need, it's in him. Praise God. It is good to see you in his house tonight. Thank you for your faithfulness to the house of God. A lot of things going on in the building tonight. Our children having their classes, our youth having service downstairs. Brother Seth is going to preach to our youth tonight. And I know they're going to have a great, great time in the Holy Ghost downstairs. And we're upstairs having a good time in the Holy Ghost tonight. And I'm thankful for that. Just a reminder, this Saturday is the second Saturday of the month, so Little Women and Bridge Builders will take place on Saturday morning, 10 a.m. And I know our children ages 7 to 11 always have a wonderful time in those sessions. Make sure your kids are here for that. It'd be a great, great time for them. And we are thrilled to have some special guests here tonight. You can be seated for a moment. Always good to have my mom in town. She came into town for Lincoln's birthday this week and to see me. It's not just Lincoln's birthday. It's always good to have her in our home and in our church. And I am thrilled tonight to have one of my very best friends in all the world, Brother Ben Nolan, who is here in service with us tonight. He had a meeting in Columbus this afternoon and was able to stick around for a few extra hours and be in service with us. He and his family have been here a few times before, but I thank God for Ben. We met in high school, and before long, he started Bible quizzing with our Bible quiz team before he ever attended our church. that ended up becoming a member of our church. We baptized him in Jesus' name in a horse trough on our back porch. And I'll never forget that day. And thank God for him. Became my parents' youth pastor for a number of years before a work transition took them to Chicago, where they're helping out in a great church plant there in the Chicago area. He's one of the foremost financial analysts when it comes to the oil and gas shipping industry. So if you have an interest there, you can talk to him about that. He's probably tired of talking about those things. I want him to come and just share a testimony with you tonight. Would you welcome my friend, Ben Nolan?
I'm never comfortable behind these things, and I apologize because I oftentimes when I speak and I have one of these microphones, I just get carried away. So in case I get carried away, you just let me know. And I do want to say that was a very kind introduction, but I tell you, it is one of the greatest honors of my life to be friends with your pastor. And it has nothing to do with him being your pastor. It has nothing to do with anything he's ever accomplished. It has everything to do with the fact that since we were freshmen in high school, he was a Christian to his very core. He's been an example to me. And that doesn't mean he's always done things perfectly, but it does mean that when he's been knocked down, he's gotten back up again. And he's been an example of how to do things the right way, all the way. And his wife is pretty good too. I apologize. I have two stories to tell, and I believe that God laid these on my heart for tonight, and I believe that I have a short word. I know that there's a lot of other things going on, but please hopefully bear with me or just calm me down. But there are two stories, and the first, this summer, that's awesome piano playing, by the way, but it might be a little while, I'm just warning. this summer we had an opportunity, we went to Yellowstone National Park, and that's a really amazing place in case you've never been, but there's a bird in Yellowstone National Park that is the strangest bird I've ever come across. It's called a Clark's Nutcracker. Has anyone ever heard of the Clark's Nutcracker? Yeah, I hadn't either. So the Clark's Nutcracker is, it looks like just a sort of a normal little bird, kind of black and white and gray and small, maybe about the size of a robin. But there's a lot of things that make this bird really unique. It really only eats one kind of food. It eats the pine nuts out of the pine cone off of the white-barked pine. That's basically all that it eats. And that's important for a couple reasons. And bear with me, I'll get to the point in a minute. But that's important for a couple reasons. First of all, the white-barked pine has these pine cones that don't open naturally. So it has no way of propagating its own self. It falls off the tree, and where it lands, that's where it dies. And the pine nuts are never able to reproduce. While squirrels and chipmunks and things will eat it, they don't really spread it. So the only way that the white-barked pine can grow and move and reproduce is through this bird, the Clark's Nutcracker. So the Clark's Nutcracker, it'll go and it'll get these pine nuts, and it'll put a bunch of them in its mouth, and it will fly around for many square miles and deposit these little stashes of pine nuts from the white-barked pine. And it's saving them for the winter. In fact, every year they'll usually collect about 100,000 of these pine nuts, and they'll deposit them oftentimes in increments of 10. So That means roughly 10,000 locations over many, many square miles. And it's storing them for the winter. And if you know anything about Yellowstone, it gets pretty cold there in the winter and a lot of snow. And God has created this magnificent little creature such that it can remember, and again, it's about the size of my fist, it can remember 70% of the locations where it deposited these pine nuts. That means 7,000 unique locations over many, many miles in up to a meter of snow. So it will know, just based on where it is, and dig down in the snow until it finds where it had gotten its pine nuts, and that will be what sustains it over the winter. Now, here's point number one. It's not my main point. If there's anybody here who doubts that God has a plan for your life, you just remember a little bit about this Clark's Nutcracker. Because if God can take a little bird about the size of my fist and give it a memory that can remember 7,000 unique locations all over the place, and not only that, it is the other 30% of the seeds that it doesn't remember, that is the only way that the white bark pine can grow and spread and everything else is those other 30%. That is how it plants itself. They're in a symbiotic relationship. The Clark's Nutcracker has to have this tree, and the tree has to have the Clark's Nutcracker. God has a plan for you. Now, here's story number two, and they'll seem a little disconnected at first, but if you could put up Joshua 24:13, maybe, hopefully, I don't know. Maybe that works. This is a pretty cool verse, and this is going to be the tricky part. I didn't know that my pastor's wife was going to be here today from Texas, but it confirms something in the Holy Ghost to me. Just so that you know, my next story, and I don't know, did that one Joshua 24:13. It's okay. I can read it off my phone. It doesn't matter. But it goes something along the lines, and this is according to this NIV. So I gave you a land which you did not toil, and cities you did not build, and you live in them, and you eat from the vineyards, and the olive groves that you did not plant. Remember that for a second, because my next story starts about 50 years ago. And it's a story of a lady. This is gonna be hard. It's a story of a lady named Mama Rathman, and she prayed for her son, and she prayed for her husband that God would draw them, that God would save them and win them. And one day, I don't know, maybe about 40, 45 years ago, that happened. God saved her son, Charles Rathbun. And so much that he felt the call of God on his life, and he wanted to respond to that call and be obedient to it. And those seeds, just like the Clark's Nutcracker, that had been planted year after year after year for her son, when she prayed and she wept and she asked God to save her son, they were planted. And they didn't pop up right away, and there wasn't a tree all of a sudden, but they were planted. And then about 40 years ago, winter came. And this is a story you might know because it's awfully close to home here. But winter came, and it seemed like the seeds had died and there was nothing left. And her son, who had been called of God, and who she had prayed for and planted seeds, passed away. And I can't imagine how heartbreaking that must have been, and how much that must have defeated her, and those aspirations and those promises that she had of God to save her family. And that was the winner. But those seeds, they didn't just die in the ground. Eventually spring came around, and those seeds that seemed like they had been lost started to grow a little bit. One of them sitting right over here. And God began to work, and those seeds and dreams that seemed to be dead started to come to life. And eventually my buddy, he too, his son, Charles's son, was filled with the Holy Ghost and was baptized in Jesus' name. And doors began to open, and things began to change, and a forest began to grow. And that's where the verse comes in. Because I didn't meet Mama Rathman until, I don't know, probably 20 years ago. She didn't know me at all. In fact, I was a long time from being born when she was planting her seeds. But when I was a freshman in high school, one of those seeds that had sprouted a tree popped up next to me. And the seeds that Mama Rathman had planted, all of a sudden, like we saw in Joshua, there were fields that she didn't plant. There were vineyards that she didn't plant. That because she did, she was faithful. And even when it was hard, and even when the winter was there, and she persisted, there was a harvest. Harvest was me. Harvest now is my kids. But harvest is my wife. And I'm here to tell you, and I believe that God gave me this for somebody here, or maybe multiple people here who have been planting seeds and have been pursuing God and asking God, for something that they can't see, just like that Clark's Nutcracker. You might not know how it's going to end up. You might not know what's going to happen. It might seem like everything is lost right now, but I'm here to tell you and prophesy, just like it was prophesied in the book of Joshua, that God is going to give you vineyards that you didn't plant, that you have no idea that they even exist. They might not even be born yet, just like I wasn't born. But it's not in vain. It's not in vain. God has a purpose and a plan for every tear that is shed, for every heart that is broken. He is working. He's working under the soil in ways that you can't understand. I'm a testament. I'm a testament to God's faithfulness. And I am trying to. We're saved by the word of our testimony and by the blood of the Lamb. Let my testimony tell you that those seeds are going to bear fruit.
Can we thank the Lord right now for His faithfulness, for His plan? Somebody needs to receive that word tonight. God's got a plan for you, even when you don't see it, when you don't know what's happening, what God is doing. God's got a plan for you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. I'm amazed at the way God operates, so far above the way that we think, so far above our ways. We are so limited in our perspective, but God sees it all, and God knows it all before we're even born. All of our days are written out, the psalmist said. Even in our mother's womb, God knows and God has a plan. God knew you'd be here on this Wednesday night a long time before we did. He knew that you'd be here, that my friend Ben would be here, that my mom would be here. God is so faithful and He's so good. We're going to continue tonight just in the vein that I believe the Holy Ghost has directed us. We started Sunday talking about the kingdom of God, and we're going to continue in that direction. Just a little review from Sunday. We talked about what the kingdom of God is. It is righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. It's in the Holy Ghost. That's where we find righteousness and peace and joy, is in the Spirit of God within us. Where is that kingdom? It's not something that we're looking for in some kind of external measure. Jesus did say to pray, "Let your kingdom come," but consider when he was giving that instruction for us to pray that prayer. It's before the day of Pentecost, before the birth of the church, before his kingdom was fully manifest. And perhaps a more relevant application of that prayer for us today would be, let your kingdom be manifest. Let your kingdom be evident. Your kingdom is here, but let it be evident. Let it be manifest in my life. Let it be manifest in our church. I declared to you on Sunday that the kingdom of God is here. It is at work within us, and it is advancing through us. Everywhere we go, the kingdom of God is present. Everywhere we go, the kingdom of God advances. And in that kingdom, there is righteousness and peace and joy. And in that kingdom, there is salvation and healing. There is deliverance in the kingdom. There is hope. There is new life. There is purpose and anointing and power. There's authority in the kingdom of God. There's dominion that he has given us in the kingdom. I believe that dominion that was lost in the garden as Adam and Eve gave in to temptation to sin, that dominion is restored through the blood of Jesus Christ and through the power of his name and the power of the Holy Ghost. We have authority, we have dominion in the kingdom. If you aren't here Sunday for the word connection message that Brother Josh Barsotti delivered concerning authority, just tremendous, powerful, I believe, so divinely inspired of the Holy Ghost. You need to get a copy of that message. There are laws in the kingdom. There are principles of the kingdom that we find in the Word of God. Now, the Bible talks about the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven. It's not talking about two different kingdoms. Those are one and the same. One description is talking about what it is. The other is talking about whose it is. It's the kingdom of heaven. It is a spiritual kingdom. The battle that we're fighting is not a carnal battle. We do not wrestle against flesh and blood. The weapons of our warfare, they are not carnal, but they're mighty through the Spirit to the pulling down of strongholds. So the kingdom of heaven is a spiritual kingdom. The kingdom of God is simply demonstrating it's his kingdom. It's his domain. But his kingdom is not everywhere. God is everywhere, but his kingdom is not everywhere. His kingdom only exists where there is submission and obedience to his word. That's where the kingdom of God exists. So while God is everywhere, not everyone is submitted to him. Not everyone is obedient to him. But where there is submission to God, where there is obedience to his word, that's where the kingdom of God exists. That is where the kingdom of God reigns. So everywhere we go in submission to the kingdom, everywhere we go in obedience to the word of God, then we are advancing the kingdom of God. Every time we're obedient to his word, the kingdom advances. When we bend our knee in prayer, the kingdom advances. When we lift our hands in worship, the kingdom advances. When you testify on the job to your coworker, the kingdom is advancing. When you are obedient to his word, when it's not popular and it's not easy and it's not what your flesh wants to do, the kingdom of God advances. There's multiple descriptions about his kingdom in scripture. We find Jesus so many times talking about the kingdom. He said, the kingdom of God is likened to a man who is sowing. The kingdom of God is likened to a mustard seed. The kingdom of God is likened to a treasure in a field. The kingdom of God is likened to a master or a king with servants. And Jesus would begin to describe and give detail about his kingdom. There's an additional element of the kingdom that I want to focus on for just a few moments tonight. Draw your attention to three specific verses in Matthew. The gospel writer Matthew wrote extensively concerning the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven. One third of the New Testament references to the kingdom of God are found in this opening book of the New Testament. Matthew chapter 4, verse 23. Speaking of Jesus, he went throughout all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom. Everybody say the gospel of the kingdom. Our kingdom has a gospel. It's the gospel. It's the good news of the kingdom. He went about proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction among the people. There's a similar verse just a few chapters later, Matthew 9, verse 35. And Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction. Do you see a pattern developing here? The gospel of the kingdom, when proclaimed by Jesus Christ, there was something about that gospel of the kingdom that brought healing. Every disease, every affliction was healed. There's something about the kingdom that brings healing, that brings protection. A final verse that we'll read from Matthew, it's in chapter 24, verse 14. It's a prophecy that contains both a promise and a warning to us. Matthew 24, verse 14. This gospel of the kingdom will be proclaimed throughout the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. What a powerful promise to us. The gospel is going to be preached throughout the whole world. It is going to be a testimony to every nation. Everyone will have an opportunity to hear the gospel. Everyone will have an opportunity to respond to the gospel. Jesus said the gospel is going to be preached throughout the entire world. But there is a warning associated with this prophetic promise. The end is going to come. There is going to be a rapture of the church. There is going to be a final judgment. It is appointed unto every man. It is both a promise and a warning to us. The gospel is going to be preached everywhere. It's available for everyone. But when the gospel has been preached throughout the entire world, and I don't know how close we are, but I have a feeling that we're pretty close to the gospel being spread throughout the entire world. Maybe just 20 years ago, 25 years ago, we would have wondered, how is that even possible? But with advancing technologies, we realize it's entirely possible if it hasn't already happened. The gospel is going to be preached everywhere, and then the end has come. We're close to the end. We have to make sure we're ready. We need to be busy about the king's business, advancing his kingdom, because the end is near. So I want to talk to you for a few moments about this element of the kingdom, the gospel of the kingdom. Everybody say the gospel of the kingdom. The term gospel brings various associated words to mind. There are, of course, the four gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. First three are the synoptic gospels because they're so similar in style and content. The fourth gospel, the Gospel of John, is really in a class all by itself, probably one of the last New Testament books that was written. And John had a very specific focus in mind, focusing on the deity of Jesus Christ in that gospel. The term gospel simply means good news. We find a definition of the gospel in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Paul said, "Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures." That is the gospel, or the good news. It is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And in Romans chapter 1, Paul would declare to us that the gospel, that death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, is the power of God unto salvation. Paul said, "I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek." I'm thankful to know the gospel tonight. I'm thankful to have experienced the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. I'm thankful to know that there is power to save us. Salvation is the purpose of the gospel. That is the goal of the gospel. That death, burial, and resurrection, it provides God with the necessary power in order to save us from our sins. Before his death, burial, and resurrection, the sins of his people were simply rolled forward, pushed forward for another year. The children of Israel were waiting until that day the Messiah would come, that perfect, sinless Lamb of God who would be slain for the sins of the entire world. But that gospel, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, is his power to save us. It is the means to set us free from our sin. It is the means to renew and restore us, to restore that relationship. Jesus said, I've come for one purpose, and that is to seek and to save that which was lost. He didn't say who was lost. He said that which was lost, that relationship that was broken in the garden. He said, I've come to seek and to save that, to restore that relationship with humanity. It's the power of God unto salvation. Romans 1:16 re-emphasizes something I mentioned on Sunday. It says it's the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes. We talked about those four words in Acts 2:38, every one of you. Four words that we so often skip over as we're talking about repentance and baptism and the Holy Ghost. But Peter said that it's available for every one of you. No one is exempt. Everyone must obey, but neither is anybody excluded. Everybody can obey. Everybody has access to the gospel. Everybody can obey the gospel. We obey the gospel, according to Acts 2:38, through that repentance, baptism in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins and receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost. That is the fullness of the answer to the question Nicodemus asked Jesus in John 3. I want us to look again. We looked at this Sunday. I told you we're just continuing in this vein. But I want to look again at John chapter 3, what Jesus specifically said about the kingdom and being born again. He said in verse 3, unless you are born again, you can't see the kingdom of God. He said in verse number 5, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. So we see that Jesus explains being born again is water baptism and spirit baptism. That's how we experience the new birth. And there's two dimensions of engagement with the kingdom that Jesus references. He talks about seeing the kingdom, and he talks about entering the kingdom. There's awareness of the kingdom, to see the kingdom, but then there is access into the kingdom. Seeing is not entering. Just being aware is not having access. But he provides for us the answer to the challenge that Nicodemus is trying to figure out. How can a man be born when he's old? He said, through the new birth, by being born of water and born of the Spirit, you can not only see or be aware of the kingdom of God, but you can have access. You can enter into the kingdom of God where that righteousness and peace and joy and healing and deliverance and provision and authority and power and anointing, all of those things that are in the kingdom. He said, through the new birth, you have access the kingdom. We find this language throughout Scripture in relation to salvation, talking about the concept of entrance, entering into. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 says, you're a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a royal priest, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of the darkness into his wonderful or marvelous light. He called us out of sin and into righteousness. He set us free from sin, and he set us free in order to live a godly life. I hope we haven't been saved too long that we've forgotten where he brought us from. I hope we haven't been living for God so long that we forgot the miry clay that he picked us out of. I'm thankful tonight to know where he brought me from. I'm thankful to understand that without him, I have no hope. Without what Christ did on the cross and the power of the gospel, that death, burial, and resurrection, I hope we haven't forgotten the darkness that he brought us out of and the chains of sin that were binding us. We're called out of sin and into righteousness. That is the gospel of the kingdom. The new birth gives us access to this kingdom. But the new birth is just that. It's the birth. Heard somebody say one time, receiving the Holy Ghost and experiencing the new birth, that's not a graduate certificate. That's a birth certificate. That's not the end. That is the beginning. The new birth is just that. It is a beginning. We emphasize the birth, and we should. We emphasize Acts 2:38, and we must, because without it, we have no access to the kingdom. But our emphasis cannot end there, because we're interested in more than just a birth. We're interested in growth. We're interested in spiritual maturity. God has more for us than just a birth. Thank God for the birth. Without the birth, we don't have anything. Thank God for the birth. But that's not where it ends. That's not where the story ends. That's not where God's purpose ends. That is just the beginning. We are interested in growth, in spiritual maturity in the kingdom of God. There's another dimension to the gospel of the kingdom beyond just awareness and beyond the entrance, beyond just having access, and it is a third level of dimension that I'll call the dimension of dwelling. It's the dimension of dwelling, because access to is not dwelling in. And God has more for us than just access to his kingdom. He has more for us than just access to his power. He has more for us than just access to an experience that maybe happens on a couple of Sundays a month. God has more for us than that. It is a dimension of dwelling. We read in Matthew 4 and Matthew 9, Jesus is preaching the gospel of the kingdom. And when he preached that gospel, it brought healing. Every sickness, every infirmity, every disease was healed. The disciples had access to that experience. They are there as he's preaching and as he is healing people. But Jesus had more in mind than them just experiencing what he was doing. He wanted them to possess the power and the authority of the kingdom. So in Luke chapter 9, Luke records a little different perspective of a different scenario where Jesus calls the 12 together. And the Bible says that he gave them power and authority over all demons and to cure diseases. And he sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal. Verse number 6 says, they departed and went through the villages, preaching the gospel and healing everywhere. It is not the will of God for us to just have access to an experience in the kingdom and never possess the power and the authority of the kingdom. Because once you have experienced the power of the gospel of his kingdom, he wants you to share that experience with somebody. He wants you to testify to somebody else. Let me tell you what the Lord did for me. Let me tell you where God brought me from. Let me tell you about the gospel, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's more than just an experience for us. It's more than just access to it. He wants us to possess it. Your healing, your deliverance is more than just for you. It's about sharing it with somebody else who can experience that same healing and that same deliverance. Let's look at the typology of the children of Israel in the Old Testament. They're in bondage in Egypt. Egypt is a type of the world. It is a type of the bondage of sin. It represents that bondage that we experience when we are bound by sin. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 22 says this, the Lord showed signs and wonders, great and grievous, against Egypt and against Pharaoh and all his household before our eyes. And he brought us out from there. Everybody say out. He brought us out from there. He had to do that before the next step could happen, that he might bring us in and give us the land that he swore to give to our fathers. He brought us out from Egypt, out from bondage, out of sin, that he might bring us in. But he had greater plans than just access. He didn't just bring us in, but then he gave us the land that he swore to give to our fathers. Possession is different than access. Yes, you have to have access to possess, but you can have access and not possess. You can be in the promise and not possess the promise. There is a difference between entering and remaining. There's a difference between visiting and dwelling. God has more in mind for us than just an occasional vacation in the promised land, just an occasional entrance into his presence, just an occasional entrance into that promise. The land of promise is available more than just access, but for our possession. God wants us to possess the land, to possess the promises he's made available to us. Now that land of promise, that's not talking about heaven. That's not paradise. It is a type. The promised land was a type of the kingdom of God here on earth, living free from sin, delivered from Egypt, and living in promise in the kingdom of God. He wants to give us possession of the promise. It's a dimension of dwelling. It's the gospel of the kingdom, dwelling in the kingdom. It's a kingdom way of life. So Moses sent 12 spies into the promised land to give a report of this kingdom that God had promised to them. 10 of those spies come back with what the Bible called an evil report. That's how the Bible describes a report of unbelief, that it was an evil report. Yes, the land flows with milk and honey. Yes, it is what God promised that it would be. Here's the fruit of it. Here's the evidence of it. But, they said, the people are strong and there's giants in the land and the cities are walled and well fortified and there's just absolutely no way that we can do this, that we can go in and possess the land. Here they have the evidence, the fruit, the evidence of God's promise, and yet they are distracted by the obstacles and the challenges that stand in their way. And the spies were confronted with a decision. In order to remain in the kingdom, it's going to require eliminating some things. We're going to have to deal with some stuff. We're going to have to take care of some enemies and some giants and some challenges. And there's some walled cities that will have to be conquered, those giants that will have to be defeated. And so here they are. They have access to the promises of God, but they're not willing to make the commitment necessary to obtain the promise and to possess the land. The gospel of the kingdom is more than just a birth. The gospel of the kingdom is more than just access. It is about possessing the power of the promise that God's made available to us. Why do some experience the new birth and never grow beyond spiritual infancy? Because possession is different than entrance. Experiencing the power and the authority of the kingdom is different than possessing the power and the authority of the kingdom. It's possible to be like those spies who gain entrance into the promised land and yet experience confronted with the challenges of the promised land and never take possession of it. A Monday walk with God is different than a Sunday experience with God. It's a different level of commitment. Possession requires obedience and submission. Possession requires commitment and sacrifice. Possession requires growth. We cannot possess the promises of the kingdom as spiritual infants. We have to grow and mature in order to possess those things. There has to be a transition from spiritual milk to spiritual meat, a place of spiritual maturity, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. It is a process and it is a journey of growth and developing in order to possess the kingdom. I'm talking about the gospel of the kingdom. I thank God for Acts 2:38, but that is just the beginning of the journey. Possessing the kingdom is about growing in that relationship with Jesus Christ. It is about growing in spiritual maturity in Him. There's strongholds that have to be broken. There are giants that we have to slay. There are walled cities that we have to conquer. The gospel of the kingdom is a way of life. It is a lifestyle of consecration and commitment that will produce the fruit of righteousness. Listen to what Peter says about this process of spiritual maturity. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 says, by His divine power, God has given us everything we need for living a godly life. We've received all of this by coming to know Him, the one who called us to Himself by means of His marvelous glory and excellence. And because of His glory and excellence, He has given us great and precious promises that He wants us to possess. These are the promises that enable you to share His divine nature and escape the world's corruption caused by human desires. In view of all this, make every effort to respond to God's promises. Supplement your faith or add to your faith a generous provision of moral excellence, and moral excellence with knowledge, and knowledge with self-control, and self-control with patient endurance, and patient endurance with godliness, and godliness with brotherly affection, and brotherly affection with love for everyone. Because the more that you grow like this, the more productive and useful you will be in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But those who fail to develop in this way are short-sighted or blind, forgetting that they have been cleansed from their old sins, forgetting what God brought us out of in Egypt, forgetting how bad that really was to be enslaved, to be in bondage in Egypt, forgetting what God has done. So, dear brothers and sisters, work hard to prove that you really are among those God has called and chosen. Do these things, and you will never fall away. Why do some fall away? Because possession is different than access. And the new birth is just the beginning. And if we never grow and develop beyond that place of the new birth, we will not have the strength. We will not have the ability to withstand the challenges that will come. Do those things, and you will never fall away. Then God will give you a grand entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The gospel of the kingdom begins with that new birth, but it is completed through the process of spiritual maturity. Listen to what Paul spoke to Titus in chapter 2, verse 11. For the grace of God, everybody say the grace of God. Anybody thankful for the grace of God? For the grace of God has appeared. It's available. We have access, bringing salvation for all people. I'm thankful for the grace of God. But listen to verse number 12. Listen to what the grace of God does. Training us, or teaching us, one translation says. This is the grace of God. I think there's a misconception today about the grace of God and what the grace of God is. The grace of God is not licensed to do whatever we want to do. The grace of God is not licensed to sin and then God just covers it all. That's not what grace is. Now, the mercy of God, the mercy of God covers up our mistakes. The mercy of God reaches beyond our failures. The mercy of God spans that great gulf between where we are and where we need to be and all the mistakes and failures that brought us to that place of bondage. That is the mercy of God. But grace is something altogether different. This is the grace of God training us. The grace of God is our teacher. It's our trainer, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave Himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for Himself a people for His own possession who are zealous for good works. We see right here in these few short verses the entire spectrum of what it means to live for God, the gospel of the kingdom, what it means to be part of the kingdom of God. There's conversion, that salvation experience. There's maturity and growth. And then ultimately, there is redemption, the rapture of the church as God redeems us unto Himself. The grace of God is not a license for us to live life any way we want to. It is a trainer, a teacher that brings about, first of all, salvation, saving us from sin, bringing us out, but then training us to live godly lives. When you think about a personal trainer, you probably have the image of somebody in mind that you're probably not best friends with your personal trainer. because their goal in life is to hurt you. Their goal is to bring as much pain as possible into your world. Your personal trainer is not saying, just sleep in tomorrow. Have another bowl of ice cream. Have another gallon of ice cream. That's not your personal trainer. They're slapping your hand when you go to reach for that ice cream. They're telling you, you got to get up earlier and you got to work harder. They're telling you, what did you do in the last week? You haven't gained any progress since the last time I saw you. What are you doing? What are you thinking? Your personal trainer is not trying to be your best friend. They're not trying to make you feel good. They're trying to make you better. And they may cause some pain in the process because they're trying to get the best out of you. And Paul said, the grace of God is our trainer. It is our teacher. It's not trying to excuse our behavior. It's trying to help us to be better and improve our behavior. The grace of God is sufficient, Jesus told Paul. It's that anointing that helps us make up the difference where we fall short, to help us be better and do better. The grace of God is the power. It is the ability to do the will of God. It's the power and the ability, that divine assistance to do what we can't do in ourselves. But the grace of God, it helps us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, to live self-controlled, upright, godly lives in this present world. That is the grace of God. It is our teacher. It's our trainer. How is it possible that the Bible says that Noah was a righteous man in such an ungodly culture where everyone's imaginations and thoughts were continually evil, and yet Noah found grace in the eyes of God? Grace was teaching him. Grace was training him. Grace was instructing him before there was a law. Before there was a commandment that said, you shall serve no other gods. Grace was teaching and training him. Entrance is not possession. Access is not possession. We have to move on from the foundation of the new birth. We stand upon it. It's our foundation, but we must build on that foundation through the power of the Spirit, the power of the Word at work in us to bring about growth and spiritual maturity. We have possessed the kingdom, and we have fully embraced the gospel of the kingdom when there is spiritual maturity. One of the greatest signs of maturity in a life is personal discipline. Discipline is a sign of maturity. Children are not very disciplined. That's why they need discipline. Children are all about right now in the moment, what do I want? What do I think I need? If it's candy, give it to me right now. I want to play. I want to do whatever makes me happy right now. But maturity begins to develop discipline. Discipline is one of the greatest signs of maturity. And there's two sources of discipline. There's personal discipline, and then there's external discipline that comes from authority in our life. Hebrews chapter number 12 gives us the understanding of what it truly means to be a child of God in His kingdom. And when we have attained that place of possession, that place of spiritual maturity, when there's discipline in our life, when we are receptive to discipline. Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 3. Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood, and have you forgotten the exhortation that addresses you as sons? My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor be weary when reproved by him. For the Lord disciplines the one he loves, and he chastises every son whom he receives. It is for discipline that you have to endure. God is treating you as sons, for what son is there whom his father does not discipline? If you are left without discipline, in which all have participated, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Besides this, we have had earthly fathers who disciplined us, and we respected them. Shall we not much more be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short time as it seemed best to them, but he disciplines us for our good, that we may share his holiness. For the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. That's the grace of God at work in us, that trains us, that disciplines us in order to live a life that will produce the fruit of righteousness. That's what it means to possess the kingdom. The gospel of the kingdom is the new birth, and it is spiritual maturity that moves us into a place of possession. As long as we stay in that infant stage, then life is a roller coaster of emotions and struggles and in and out, back and forth, tossed to and fro, and it's maybe a Sunday high and a Monday low, and we feel like we're just being tossed about by life. But when we possess the kingdom, even in the middle of a storm, we can have peace. When we possess the kingdom, even in the face of temptation, we can have confidence. When we possess the kingdom, we lose our job or we get a diagnosis that isn't what we wanted, but we are still so strong in our faith and assured and confident that God is with us because we have possessed the kingdom. It is the will of God for every individual here tonight to have more than access. God wants you to possess the kingdom, to possess the power and the anointing, the glory, the authority of his kingdom. I want our musicians to come. When we have developed personal discipline, and when we can receive discipline, then we have attained spiritual maturity in the kingdom. Then the gospel of the kingdom is at work within us. When we allow the word and the spirit to produce growth within us, then we have graduated from the school of the kingdom. I want you to stand with me tonight. When we've developed personal discipline, and when we can receive discipline, the writer of Hebrews said that he disciplines those that he loves. His grace instructs, it trains, it motivates, it inspires. If you've ever had a personal trainer, they've probably screamed at you a time or two to create a little motivation. Try to create a little inspiration. Grace, his grace is training us. It is disciplining us. It is instructing us so that we can grow. He wants us to be strong. He wants us to possess his promises, to possess his kingdom. 2 Corinthians chapter 11 talks about another gospel. There's other gospels than the gospel of the kingdom. There's other gospels that are out there. There are some who have a gospel with no cross, a gospel with no commitment, a gospel with no sacrifice, a gospel with no discipline. But that gospel does not gain you access to his kingdom. But the gospel of the kingdom, there may be some times where some pressure is applied. There may be some times where that discipline is not comfortable. In fact, the very definition of discipline is delaying what I want today so I can have something greater tomorrow. It's saying no to the flesh today, resisting the impulse of the flesh today because there's something that's greater that's available for me down the road if I can just say no today. There's all kinds of interesting studies that have been done just testing our human nature, and a sign of discipline, a sign of maturity is being able to say no to something that's enticing right now in order to wait 30 minutes, an hour, a day, next week, next month, next year for something greater that's in store. That's the sign of spiritual discipline, spiritual maturity. The Spirit is calling us to a place of possession, more than just an experience, more than just access, to possess His promise, to possess His kingdom. That's when the kingdom lives in us. The children of Israel wandered in the wilderness for 40 years because they weren't willing to confront some giants and deal with some walled cities. And for 40 years, they wander in a wilderness till everybody dies who doubted, until there was another generation that arose that said, we're willing to possess the kingdom. There's some promises that are available. There's some promises available tonight that you can possess. God's got greater things in store for you. God's got some things ahead of you. But it's going to take that discipline. It's going to take that commitment, maybe a few sacrifices today in order to advance the kingdom. Would you take a moment with me right now and let's just close our eyes, open our hearts, and just begin to seek the Lord. I believe the Holy Ghost would speak some things into your spirit right now. I believe the Holy Ghost would take this word today and connect it with that hunger and that desire, that passion in your spirit for the kingdom, to possess the kingdom. Maybe somebody tonight is dissatisfied with where you are. I am appealing to your spiritual passion tonight to advance from where you are, to take that step into possession, to take that step more than just access into His kingdom, but to possess the kingdom of God, for His kingdom to operate in you, for healing not to just flow to you, but flow through you, for that anointing not just to flow to you, but to begin to flow through you. Would you just begin to call on the Lord right now? Would you make yourself available to Him and let the Holy Ghost just begin to speak into your spirit right now? Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. It's the gospel of the kingdom. It's the power of God to save. It's the power of God to deliver. It's the power of God to anoint you, to give you authority, to give you dominion. It's the power of the gospel. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. As they begin to sing right now, I want to open these altars to anybody tonight who would like to possess the kingdom. Is there anybody that would just like to step out and possess some promises tonight? If there's a drawing in your spirit for more, if there's a desire in your spirit for more, you're not satisfied where you are, you're not satisfied with your relationship with God, but you feel like God has more for you, I want you to step out and possess the kingdom. Let the power of the gospel of His kingdom begin to do a work in you.
Let your kingdom.
Oh, yes.
Earth is changing.
God, I want to possess your kingdom. I'm going to possess your promises, God.
Let your kingdom come. Your kingdom comes. The earth is shaking, chains are breaking as your kingdom comes. Let your kingdom come.
Everything changes.
Everything changes when your kingdom comes. Let your kingdom come.
Mountains have to move,
changes when your kingdom comes.
Oh, when your kingdom comes.
Oh,
the earth is shaking.
Chains are breaking as your kingdom comes. Let your kingdom come.
Everything changes.
Your kingdom come. The earth is shaking, chains are breaking as your kingdom comes. Let your kingdom come. Mountains have to move, and every chain is loose.
God, we declare that your kingdom is here.
Your kingdom is here, and everyone will see. Fall down at your feet, and God, we declare that your kingdom is here, and everything changes. Everything changes when your kingdom comes. Let your kingdom.
Somebody just needs to say yes to the Holy Ghost right now. Whenever God's speaking into your spirit, yes, God. Yes, God, I surrender to that call of the kingdom. I submit myself to that challenge of the kingdom right now. Yes, God. Yes to your will. I'm saying no to my flesh. I'm saying no to my will so I can say yes to your will. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
To thee, my blessed Savior,
I surrender all. I surrender all. I give it all to you, God, because I want to possess the kingdom. I surrender it all to you, God, because there's some promises that I want to claim. Hallelujah. We can't possess his kingdom as long as we're holding on to our kingdom. We can't possess his promises. Willing to trust him. Oh, yes, I surrender all to Jesus. Oh, yes. surrender all. I surrender all to you. We all sing that together as a prayer of commitment to Him right now. Oh, yes.
Oh, I surrender.
I give it all to you. I give it all to you, Jesus. More than just a song, can we do that right now? Come on, more than just words to a song. Let's put that song into action right now and just open our spirit to Him. I give it all to you, God. I surrender it all to you, God. I trust you, God. I put my confidence in you, God. I surrender every fear, every question, God, every anxiety that I'm dealing with right now, I give it to you. I surrender it to you, God. My own will, my own agenda, my own desires, I surrender to you. My kingdom, God, I lay it down at this altar right now because I want to possess your kingdom. I want to dwell in your kingdom. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm thankful to be part of His kingdom. I'm thankful for access to His kingdom. But more than that, I'm thankful for the opportunity to dwell in that land of promise. It's available to all of us. It's available to all of us tonight. Jesus said, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness." His kingdom has to be our highest priority. It's got to be our aim, our goal, our consuming passion. Seek first His kingdom. He spoke that in the context of dealing with the natural needs that we have. And He said all of those things are going to be added to you, or they're going to be taken care of. All of your needs are going to be provided if you seek first my kingdom. Pursue my kingdom. Have a passion for my kingdom. He said, everything else, I'll take care of it. I'll deal with it. I'll provide it if you seek my kingdom first. I want to possess that kingdom. I'm going to pursue that kingdom. I'm going to possess that kingdom. Are you thankful for His kingdom tonight? Everything that's available in His kingdom, I'm thankful for it. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I want you to be in prayer with me concerning our service Sunday. I mentioned to the church on Monday night, those who were here for our prayer meeting, just I feel a very strong burden for our service Sunday, a very specific direction. God's been dealing with me for several months, and I feel the release to preach this Sunday. I want you to be in prayer with me for this Sunday. I want you to be intentional about your conversations the next few days, those that you talk to that would express a hunger for God, maybe those who have drifted away from God, those who are struggling in their relationship with God. I want you to be intentional about praying for them and inviting them to be with us in service on Sunday. And I believe the Lord is going to speak a very, very direct word to us. And pray with me that the will of God would be accomplished in our service this Sunday. Everywhere you go this week, your neighborhood, at work, throughout our community, advance the kingdom of God. Share your testimony with somebody. Pray for somebody. Bless
somebody. Everywhere you go, you're advancing His kingdom. When we live in submission and obedience to His word, advance the kingdom of God. God bless you. Thank you for being here in our Wednesday night service. Greet one another in the name of the Lord. You're dismissed.
Jesus, there is.